This is Aishwarya Mohan. Our topic is Pagans and Heathens, Man's Association with Nature and Its Impacts. So this is the outline of our presentation.
Okay.
So this is an attempt to understand man's association with nature from most ancient times. So one of the striking aspects about the pagan gods and goddesses from around the world is its extraordinary connection with nature. Ancient Egyptians, Indians, Greeks, Romans, and Chinese were worshippers of Mother Nature. Pagans had deities of the fields, fertility deities, lunar deities, etc. For instance, Egyptians worshipped cats, crocodiles, serpents, dogs, etc. Many gods and festivals of pagans are associated with nature worship. Summer solstice has long been a time when different cultures celebrated lengthening year. So let us have a look at the belief systems and practices of various sects around the globe. So Elignac was a lunar deity, the god of both weather and moon. He controls tides. He used to control tides and presides both earthquakes and eclipses. Mitra, another pagan god of sun, who was born around the time of winter solstice. Saturn was the Roman god of seed. In December, they used to have a week-long celebration called Saturnalia in honor of their agricultural god, Saturn. In this picture, you can see the remains of Saturn temple at Rome. Pan, the Greek god of nature. So coming to India, Prithvi, actually the indigenous people, they worship everything. They treated everything in nature as a divine entity or an expression of divinity. So the Varuna was the god of water. So they lived in tandem with nature, with respecting and loving everything. So I'm reminded of a quote of Gandhiji. I bow my head in reverence to our ancestors for their sense of the beautiful in nature and for their foresight in investing beautiful manifestations of nature with a religious significance. So my co-presenter Suraj Rajendran will take over from here.
Namaste. If this was the case around the globe, then what is the factor which made a change in man's attitude towards worshipping nature or reverence towards nature? That is what I'm looking into. And for that, let me just share this view of Genesis on nature. This is a Genesis quote from chapter 1, verse number 28, which says, Be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it. Rule over the fish of the sea and the birds of the air and even the creature that crawls upon the earth. This reminds me of a thought which seems to have gifted man a free hand to dominate and subjugate over the plants and the animal kingdom. Genesis further says, "Behold, I have given you every seed-bearing plant on the face of all the earth, and even trees whose fruit contains seed. They will be yours for food." It goes on to add, "And every beast of the earth, and every bird of the air, and every creature that crawls upon the earth, everything that has the breath of life in it, I have given every green plant for food." This idea of domination, which was laid down by Genesis, had shown the change in man's reverential attitude towards nature to a more destructive attitude towards nature. Animism, we use the term animism used to denote the worship of spirit and forces of nature as opposed to a true God. This basis principle in Western thought is to this day is still widely used to describe the pagan and the heathen faiths. The true God followers force their God concept into heads of other human beings around the globe, and that made man's attitude a dimensional shift in what it was there from the very beginning. If this is the case, then again, if you look at the contemporary belief systems, we can see the indigenous people of India worshipping sacred groves. This is a very common scene in Kerala, where we could see hundreds of sacred groves still preserved even after the British colonization, which came to Kerala in the mid 18th century and which even left Kerala only at 1950s. So even that colonization couldn't destroy major concepts from the indigenous people of Kerala. That is why we could see sacred groves sustaining or even still surviving in the culture of Keralites. Sacred groves are nothing but natural vegetation worshipped, natural vegetation plus we can see deities in this place where people worship those deities as well. And there is another temple which I can show is Shabarimala. Shabarimala is one of the famous temple which is in the Pathanamthitta district of Kerala. This temple actually protects 18 hills around the temple. There are 18 hills. This is called as Pungavanams. Padrinth Pungavanam, it seems in Malayalam. All those mountains are protected. Why? Because almost all the, for rituals and all, the ingredients they take from all these mountains. So it became a part and parcel of the indigenous people's life to protect that particular mountains around Shabarimala. But if you go 100 kilometers away from Shabarimala, you could see another hill station called Munar. That is actually a tourist attraction nowadays. This was an area where the Britishers came in the mid 18th century and they destroyed entire forest across their area and they started planting teas. Teas, as you all may know, that this is not something which is helping the nature. It is actually a destruction to the nature. And if you could see the last two floods which happened in Kerala, this area was mostly affected. This area was, the inhabitants of this particular area was badly affected. But Shabarimala, 100 kilometers away from this area, was widely protected. So what we could see is like the Western philosophy idea to worship only one God and just wiping out other indigenous cultures have really harmed our ecology. And this, I'm remembered of a thesis written by Lyon Wright in Nature, where he says dogmatic religion, in absolute contrast to the ancient paganism and Asian religion, not only established the dualism of man and nature, but also insisted that it is God's will that man exploit nature for his proper ends. So this attitude is something which we need to look upon. Earlier in the slide, Aishwarya shown the picture of Pan, the god which was an agricultural god among the pagans. What these dogmatic religions did was they destroyed the Pan concept, and even they extended it. They just globalized Pan as a symbol of devil. As a symbol of devil, in a sense, Pan is not nowadays worshipped. The concept is wiped out, but that image is there in common man's mind as devil. So what we face right now is not just the nature issues or all the issues by environment. It's not just a man-made issue. It is a spiritual crisis where we can solve, we can find out our solution from our cultural roots. Our conclusion of this study is that it is necessary to understand the Western culture, Western philosophy, and its history to identify the root cause of nature destruction. Our ecological troubles are so largely a spiritual crisis, so the solution must also be spiritual. In a sense, going back to our roots is what the solution which we through this study will offer. Humanity needs those who see oneness in everyone, godness in every living and non-living creature of this planet. Then only we will be able to solve the problem related with nature. I'll end by saying that a garden of roses might be beautiful, but it should not be at the falling of an enchanting forest. Thank you.
Okay, Suraji, I think the paper has come to a conclusion. If there are any questions, we can take up a few questions for this paper. Are there questions? How can we bring back the reverence of Mother Nature into Hindu mind? We need a simultaneously pro-Hindu, pro-green movement politically. Forest Rights Act is harmful. Okay. I don't know to whom this question is addressed, but there is a question. How can we bring back reverence for Mother Nature into Hindu mind? We need a simultaneously pro-Hindu, pro-green movement politically. Forest Rights Act is harmful. That is the question. Probably it's a very general question. How can we bring pro-green, pro-Hindu, pro-green movement? Suraj Rajendranji, do you want to answer that question or do we pass? You have to unmute yourself. You are muted.
Okay.
Now, yeah, please.
Yes, Nagaraji, what we would suggest through our study is like we should bring back all the indigenous concepts and we should promote all those things. Especially in the Western Europe, we are seeing a revival of paganism. Likewise, we should promote our sacred root guru concepts across the globe, and we should try to bring back man's attention towards the nature revering attitude of Hinduism and even in the pagans and other indigenous people. I mean, that is what my suggestion would be.
There is one more question. Do you think there is a concerted effort to Abrahamize Hinduism and divorce it from its pagan roots? This is from Rohanji.
That attempt is already there from the very beginning. If you look at the British colonizing time, that colonization itself was a religious thing which have attempted to lure away our people and pollute their minds with Western thoughts. So yes, we should find a way to control that. Or we should find a way to educate our people about our belief systems and our concepts towards nature.
There is one from Raghav Krishna ji. He is saying, Suraj Rajendran ji, you are from Kerala. Kerala being in the grip of communist regime and two large Abrahamic faiths. Is it possible there to revive an environmental crisis when all these movements, communist, Abrahamic faiths, all are anti-environmental, and they are the responsible aspects of environmental crisis? How about Kerala?
About Kerala, in the sense, without blaming anyone, what I would like to say is, like, even Kerala, that is what even in our presentation we said. Even after colonization for more than 100 years, we could able to preserve our groves. Even if you come to Kerala, you'll be able to see that all the temples are preserved. I'm not saying they're totally preserved, but we have actually able to preserve majority of our temples. And even the concept of nature reverence is still there in Kerala, that you could see from our sacred groves across Kerala. And all other things that we need.
Yeah, I think we have taken already 3 questions. So probably we can now move on to Chitra Madhavan ji.